What's up, Eco Nerdlings? In this podcast, we're going to be discussing water purification and conservation. So let's go ahead and get started. So water purification, with all of the water that we need to use, we need to have somehow or some way to purify that water and make it drinkable or usable for us. So countries without access to groundwater or surface water sometimes result to the process of desalination. This is the removal of salt from salt water in order for us to use it as fresh water. So this is an example of one of those plants located in Tampa, Florida. So desalinated water is much, much more expensive due to the high energy costs for actually operating the plants that will remove the salt from that water. So human sewage is obviously a huge problem, and it's unavoidable because we all produce waste. But it can actually be treated and minimized in order to minimize the environmental impacts from that waste. So we have what we call the very first process, which is screening. This removes any trash or large objects that may have entered the sewage stream. Trash in the form of, yes ladies, I'm about to say it, tampons. We have tampons that are in there, obviously toilet paper. Unfortunately, some people put paper towels in there, which are not supposed to go into our sewage, but a lot of people will flush paper towels. Baby wipes are actually not supposed to be flushed, but a lot of people flush baby wipes. All of those different components create a huge, huge amount of trash that actually has to get screened from the sewage as it comes into the wastewater treatment plants. So we have primary treatment. This is what holds the sewage in a large containment vessel. The heavy solids, yes, those solids, sink to the bottom, and those are removed in the form of sludge. It may also be aerated, meaning left out in the open, to remove as much of the smell as possible. Even though it's removing the smell, you probably don't want to be in the immediate vicinity when they are actually aerating it, because that doesn't smell very nice at all. So the sludge that is left over from those treatments, sometimes it's decomposed using bacteria, and eventually it can also be composted. So the secondary treatment adds bacteria to decompose dissolved organic matter. Organic meaning it contains carbon. The bacteria also eventually have to be killed once they have conducted their process. That means that we add a lot of times chlorine in order to disinfect the water. Sometimes we also have a tertiary treatment, and this can also remove different things such as removal of nitrates as well as phosphates from the water. If we're trying to prevent, you know, algal blooms and things like that, if that water is going back into an immediate, you know, stream or a river that's very close by. So sometimes we have sewer overflow, not very present. This is when sewage treatment plants have a limited amount of water that they can process at any given time. So if that amount of water goes over the amount that they can process at one time, you get an overflow. So for example, if a flood occurs, if we have a huge snowmelt or another excess water event occurs, raw sewage can unfortunately be dumped directly into a nearby water source. So such as right here in the Milwaukee Harbor. That's what you see coming into the harbor right here from a wastewater treatment facility. So drinking water. Obviously we need to have clean drinking water, and we need to make sure that it's safe. So municipal tap water, meaning water that's used by the community, is regulated by the Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA. They have standards that were established within the Safe Drinking Water Act, which was passed in 1974. Bottled water is regulated by the Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA, instead of the EPA. And the FDA is actually much strict when they're testing water, so they have less standards. The FDA has set several different types of classifications for bottled water. So, we have artesian water. This is from an aquifer, such as Fiji water. We have distilled water. This is water that's basically been boiled and recollected. It doesn't contain any of those minerals that a lot of times if you look at one of the purified bottles of water, it might contain different trace elements and things like that. Well, distilled water does not. And a lot of times we use distilled water in laboratory investigations to make sure we don't have any cross-contamination of any other substance. So distilled water can include water brands such as Glishow. And then we have purified water. This is basically tap water that different plants have purified. It's been filtered or deionized or they use reverse osmosis, such as Aquafina and Dasani water. We also have spring water, like this wonderful water that I have here that I'm going to take a sip of now. All right, so spring water comes from an underground formation that naturally flows to the surface, such as Evian or Ozarka. So random fun fact, looking over here, our Aquafina water, the Aquafina used to label their water as PWS instead of public water supply, giving the impression that it was some type of spring water because nobody knew what PWS was until they realized that it was public water supply. So it was nothing really special. So domestic water conservation. Well, estimates suggest that most societies could save as much as half of their current domestic water usage without really sacrificing or making any serious changes in their lifestyles. So what are some of the biggest domestic uses of water? Toilet flushing. Yes. When we flush the toilet, we are wasting a ton of water. Aside from that, bathing is going to be a huge, huge, huge use of water that we're doing, as well as our laundry and dishes. The water that we use for drinking water and cooking or brushing our teeth isn't very, very large, so it only composes about 11% of our water usage, with everything else comprising the rest. So, how can we help to conserve water? Well, looking over here, we have the dual flush toilet. Yes, we have two buttons. Very easy to operate. It has a half flush for your liquid waste, so if you pee, you can do the half flush, or a full flush for your solid wastes. We also have now high-efficiency washing machines. So a lot of times if you go to the store and you're trying to find detergent for yourself, some of them will say HE. That means high efficiency. Those are the front-loading washers. They use a lot less water than the top-loading washers that are the older brands. So another thing that you can do to help consume water or conserve water is to have a water-saving shower head. So the typical shower head releases about 2.5 gallons of water per minute, while the water-saving shower head releases only about 1.5 gallons per minute, saving an entire gallon of water for each minute that you're in the shower. Well, I hope you learned a little bit about water conservation today. If you'd like to rewatch this video lecture or find many others over the AP Environmental Science topics, you can at my website, www.nerdlingscience.com. Well, I hope you guys had fun. I will see you next time. This is the Queen Nerdling signing out. Stay nerdy until next time.